Hello everyone. In this lecture, we are starting with IoT application development part device storage unstructured data. So the IoT has been touted as the next challenge for enterprise to adopt and exploit. But what exactly in IoT and how does it affect on storage and the way we manage our data? So IoT refers to a broad network of physical devices that include sensors, vehicles, mobile devices, and even home appliances that create and share the data. For enterprises, this can mean cameras that monitor football, servers that run plant machinery, data collected from remote or branch offices or any location in which business operates. So typically, IoT devices are seen as individual, remotely managed, and embedded appliances such as camera. But this is not the way which always works. So many businesses have distributed environments that runs one or more servers, branch locations, to monitor building access, environmental controls, or other tasks that relate directly to the business itself. As a result, IoT is a mesh of devices that could create, store, and process content across many physical locations. So this is possible that we can collect or we have to collect large amount of data because of IoT. So that data might be unstructured kind of data. So how to work on that data while storing that data? So first thing is distributed data and IoT. Probably the most obvious treatment here is that the information created is outside the data center. We are increasingly seeing the term edge used to describe computing and data management tasks performed outside core data centers. So edge computing has existed for many years. The current evolution in IoT and edge computing is notable for the sheer volume of data created in non-core data center location. So it brings unique challenges to IT department that must ensure that data is adequately secured and processed. For that, most IT organizations are used to knowing exactly where the data resides. So with IoT, the challenge of putting arms around the all content by business is much greater, and obvious implication on users' privacy and regulation, such as general data protection regulation. Next is distributed processing. With the possibility of so much information being created at the edge, it's impossible to move the data to data center for processing in a timely fashion. So third party to consider is timely processing of data. IoT devices may need to make local processing decisions quickly and not tolerate the latency of reading and writing the data. So this distributed data and processing requirement means that businesses need to add the capability to push compute and applications to the edge end, in many cases pre-processed data, before it is uploaded to the core data center for long-term processing. The information life cycle of IoT, what it consists of, it is a broad aspiration of IT organization that initially this meant having the ability to move data between storage as a content and became less valuable. Nowadays, the data is in large format. So over time, the data can be consolidated into core locations for further processing. So information lifecycle management is the thing where we have to look to directly optimize the cost of storing data, but instead to ensure it can be placed in the right location for processing needed at the time. So we are starting to see the flow of information from the edge into core location that can continue to derive value long after the data was initially created. So after creating the data, what we have to do is we have to put the data onto the cloud. So we have to use the public cloud or private cloud. So IoT data is mostly unstructured and so can be easily stored in public cloud infrastructure. All the major cloud providers offer low-cost scalable storage system based on object storage technology. With high-speed networks and no charge for data integrity, public cloud is a great location to store the volumes of IoT data being generated by businesses. Cloud service providers have extended their product offerings to include big data analytics tools that process large volumes of unstructured data. Next is supplier solution in IoT. Looking at what suppliers are developing, we see a range of products and solutions. So some startup companies are developing insight processing storage devices that allow data to be analyzed at the edge. AWS provides the capability to import edge data into AWS S3 using Snowball. Google already offers services in Google Cloud Platform. Store Magic, a UK-based company, provides the capability to deploy scalable storage at the edge. HCP from Hitachi Vantara can be used as a centralized object store and achieve for IoT data. So these are some suppliers for the IoT, and they are providing their own solutions for saving or storing the large amount of data. In spite of this also, we are having some challenges in IoT. So what becomes obvious when looking at the range of storage solutions on offer is lack of standardization in the market today. So there are no clear best practices or industry standards to ensure distributed data securely accessed and transported into core data centers. Data is typically moved in asynchronous fashion, which is somewhat risky. And the challenges for data storage and data management companies is to develop standards and tools that treat data outside the data center with the same level of security and consistency as within our public and private clouds. So the thing is, while generating the data by using different kinds of sensors and gateways, what we have to do is we have to save the data into the cloud. So the most probable challenge for the IoT is security of data and storage of the data. So next thing is storage on cloud or local server. Cloud computing starts with the data services and architecture. It should be on servers. They should be in cloud somewhere. And that if you have right kind of browser on right kind of access, it doesn't matter whether you are having PC or mobile phone or BlackBerry. Or what you have or new device still to be developed, you can get access to the cloud. So the cloud computing is a natural evolution of related existing and new concepts in the information and communication technologies area based on the widespread adoption of virtualization, cluster computing, grid computing, service-oriented architecture, web services, parallel and distributed file system, load balance and batch scheduling, autonomic and utility computing technologies. So you can get some idea about cloud computing, that how wide it is. In fact, cloud computing is correlated with many other terms that were already in the ICT industry, such as grid computing, utility computing. These are the things comes under the cloud computing. So Amazon played a key role in the development of cloud computing. After the dot-com bubble, most data centers were using as little as 10% of their capacity at any one time, just to leave room for occasional spikes. So in spite of this, Amazon developed AWS services to store large amount of data over it, and you can securely access that data also. With this, there comes cloud hierarchy. So basically three things included into it: software as a service, platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. So it depends on the what kind of job you are doing. You have to use the services provided by the cloud free of cost anytime and anywhere. So you can use different softwares, you can use the platforms, you can use the infrastructures provided by the cloud. Next is grid computing. So same like IoT, the technological foundation of cloud computing is distributed computing based on communication networks. So one of the most directly related work is cluster of workstations, and it comes along with the grid computing. So Google servers were based on the same philosophy, clusters of workstations. For that, next is Hadoop. Hadoop is the well-known open source implementation of Google's Bigtable and MapReduce. So it is high computing batch processing system, application customized for embarrassingly parallel internet-based massive data processing. So grid computing is the direct technological ancestor of cloud computing, which also has the roots of cluster of workstation technologies. Some of the well-known cloud systems are directly transformed from earlier grid computing to cloud computing. So with this comes virtualization. So what basically these things tells us that we are having a structure or we are having a cluster of workstations. So for everything you have to create, or you are having workstations. So if you are clustering them, you can say that Hadoop is a structure where you can use MapReduce structure and you can go or enter with a large amount of database. And you can check your data there, you can save your data there. With this, grid computing comes. Grid computing is same like cloud computing. So before cloud, there was grid computing and large applications were using it. So how it actually done? For that, we have to see, or we have to go for the virtualization. So virtualization is another important concept often mentioned with cloud computing. So there are two sides of virtualization. First one is single system virtualization, and second one is multi-system virtualization. So utility computing also comes with it. It contains both single system and multi-system virtualization. It is provided by IBM, and both the technologies are using the hypervisor technology. So what it basically means, so there are some clusters in the cloud, and this large amount of cluster contains cluster controller, storage controller, and node controllers. And by combining these three things, one cluster will be formed. Likewise, number of clusters are there, and all these clusters are handled by cloud controller. And this cloud controller is directly accessible by any web browser. So number of clusters are there, and inside that clusters, different applications are there, different hosts are there, different data structures are there, and these clusters are managed by the cloud controller. So virtualization is a concept where you have to consider that, or where you can consider that many systems are running on one system, or single system is running on another single system. So by these concepts, you can go for the cloud computing. So modern single system virtualization technologies are similar to the hypervisor technologies that IBM uses right now, or before decades also it was using it. The purpose of it is to simulate multiple computers on the top of one computer, run multiple operating systems on one computer, and it will increase the power of single computer and increase efficiency of overall resources. Okay, so these are the things which tells us that cloud computing is the fusion of grid computing and SOA technologies, system application technologies, to provide everything as a utility style services. So it is a large scale distributed computing platform where The pool of abstracted, virtualized, dynamically scalable, managed computing power, storage platform, and service-oriented architectures are developed. So these are the reasons why IoT system have to go for the cloud system, and why not they are creating or generating their own database. So why they are using the cloud. So cloud is the thing where you can save large amount of data, you can access it. We are going through all the things that what is Hadoop, what is virtualization, what is utility computing. So these are the things, or you can say features of the cloud, and because of this only the things are going for the cloud. So the thing is cloud middleware. So what is it? Cloud middleware is a software layer that sits between applications and the objects. So we can see the application, and what are the objects means the object can consist of clusters. Object can be a cluster controller, storage controller, node controller, where we have actually stored our data. So middleware works as a middle part for application and the object. So it aims to provide solutions to frequently encountered problems such as interoperability, security, or dependability. So there are some characteristics of middleware. So middleware is an important enabler which provides communications among application and the object, and it brings flexibility and it brings transparency to the system. So there are some characteristics of middleware. So we will go one by one. First one is flexibility. So this is the most important capability. Then by using this, or there are different kinds of flexibility, such as response time, delay flexibility. Flexibility moves from application level to middleware level in order to handle different forms of flexibility. Level of flexibility is important because high level of flexibility means more connectivity between the applications and processes. Next is transparency. Transparency is the feature of middleware that can be very helpful for programmers or end users. There are basically two types of transparencies. First one is platform transparency, second one is network transparency. Next is interoperability. Interoperability means two sets of applications on interconnected networks be able to exchange data and services with different assumptions, protocols, data models, etc. Next is context management, which shows that coordination management. It allows users to choose and configure a service or subject in one application, and then all other applications which contain information about that specific subject will adjust themselves with the same settings that user defined previously. This we can say is a main pillar of context-aware systems also. Next is reusability. So there are possibility to reuse softwares and hardwares because there is no specific technology to impose its policies for service implementations. It is used to make designing and developments easier by modifying system components. Means whatever we are having before anything, so we can use that to modify the system components and assets for specific requirements. Next is platform portability. It is a critical feature actually. There are many mobile hardware and software components which are constantly moving between different platforms. So middleware runs in user side and can provide independence from network protocol, programming language, or operating systems, etc. Next is maintainability. So this is the ability of system, applications, or devices to respond to failures properly and rapidly return to normal functionalities without any problem. Next is resource discovery. So inside the network, resource discovery is actually a process that is used by node to search and probe for intended resources such as service or data types among entire nodes of a network. Next is trustworthiness management. This is capability to require or is required in social Internet of Things application, plays key role in establishing trust relationship among different applications. Next is adaptability. So any new changes will come into the picture due to different reasons, including nodes mobility, powertrain topology, shifts, and etc. So the middleware should be in such a type that it should be adoptable by all the new changes into it. Next is security and privacy. Security in middleware is a very important issue because most of the data transmission and operations are occurring through it. Next is connectivity convergence. So Internet of Things contains and supports various types of hardware and softwares, where components that interact with each other through components are interacting with each other through communication platforms. So on another side of scheme, objects may use communication technologies for this purpose. We can say that we can have the connectivity of convergence into it. So these are some characteristics of cloud middleware. So in this lecture, what we have seen is why to go for cloud and what is the thing actually. So we are generating the data by using the IoT. We are making large amount of data. For that, to save that data or to store that data, we have to go for the cloud. So why we have to go for the cloud is the thing we have seen in this lecture. Thank you.